Well, good morning. Today we're going to look at the question, how many tweets are possible? Well, everybody uses Twitter, and in Twitter you can create tweets consisting of up to 140 characters in a character string that you type in from your keyboard. And so I got kind of curious, how many tweets are actually possible? And so we're going to show how you get this, but I'll just tell you the answer right now. The number of possible tweets using just standard characters on the keyboard is equal to 94 times 95 to the 139th power. And you can rewrite this in scientific notation. The number of tweets is equal to 10 to the 276.8767, and so forth, around 10 to the 277th power. That is a pretty darn big number. For instance, you can rewrite this in terms of powers of the number googol, 10 to the 100. And the number of tweets is actually equal to g to the 2.7687, so on. So it's bigger than the square of the number googol. So I don't know if this has any corporate implications, that tweets are much bigger than googol's, but there's a kind of a memory trick. A tweet is a little bit larger, but almost equal to googol raised to the e power, where e is the base of the natural logarithm. Okay, so to get a count, to get a number of tweets possible, we have to come up with a mathematical description of a tweet. So how do we do that? Well, when you enter characters from the keyboard, what you're doing is establishing a correspondence between the numbers 1 through 140 and the characters available on the keyboard, you know, including funny characters like question marks and uppercase and lowercase, at signs, and so forth. So when you establish a correspondence, that in mathematics is describing a function. So let's write this out as a function. So let's make this pictorial. We're going to describe the domain of the tweet function as a bunch of boxes. So you have 140 boxes here, numbered from 1 up to 140. And the idea is you're going to be able to put characters in these boxes at your discretion. So we have 140 boxes ordered by the numbers 1 through 140. And so B is an ordered set, in the sense that the parameter, the box number, is a parameter that's ordered by the ordering of those natural numbers. And then we have the set of characters that are available on the keyboard that are allowed in tweets. And so if you go through and just count these up, you know, you have the numbers 1 through 9 and 0 and some funny characters here, and so on, the alphabetic characters. And you also have the space bar, and so tweets can contain space bars. So there's 95 characters, including the space bar. Tweets have an idiosyncrasy. The space bar cannot appear in box 1. That is, Twitter doesn't allow you to have a space at the beginning of your tweet. But otherwise, you can have a space anywhere else in the tweet you want. And you can type in any of these 94 other characters or a spacebar. So the tweet, a tweet, when you construct a tweet, that's a function that's mapping the set of boxes to the set of characters. Okay, so we have a description of a tweet as a function mapping boxes to characters. Now, you know, when you're typing in characters at the keyboard, you might be thinking, well, wait a second, I'm really mapping the keyboard characters to these boxes. But that doesn't work because tweets can have repeated characters. And so one thing about functions is that you cannot have a element of the domain mapped to two different characters in the codomain. So functions can be one-to-one, many-to-one, but they cannot be one-to-many. So the function is mapping the numbers 1 through 140, visualized here as 140 boxes in the set B, to the set C of characters. So we've reduced then the problem. We can reformulate the question of how many tweets are possible to this question here. How many distinct functions exist that map the set of 140 boxes to the codomain of characters? Well, there are several different ways to approach this problem, but here's one that's kind of elegant, and I like it. So we're going to do that one first. There are other ways to do this, and we'll talk about those later. But how many functions exist mapping the set B to the set C? Well, there's a theorem in function theory called the Map Counting Theorem. And the Map Counting Theorem says that the set of all functions mapping the domain B to the codomain C has a cardinality of C raised to the B power. And these absolute value signs on a set, this indicates the cardinality of the set C. So we're raising the codomain to the power of the domain. So when you talk about these collections of functions, we can write that in set notation. The set of all functions, the set of all f's, we're going to call that capital F. And in function theory, this is sometimes denoted that f is equal to the codomain raised to the domain power as a set, and the cardinality of the set f is equal to the cardinality of the codomain raised to the domain, cardinality of the domain. So that's kind of useful. It's sort of like a theorem here that's going to give us our answer. So how many tweets, let's go over here, how many tweets exist? We have a tweet as a function that maps 140 ordered boxes to 95 characters. So a tweet is T maps boxes to characters. Okay. And using the map counting theorem, we have the total number of such functions, the cardinality of the tweet functions is equal to C to the B power. So that's 95 to 140. So that's a pretty big number, and we're almost done. There's one idiosyncrasy, as we mentioned before, you know, you can't have a space in the first box when you're making a tweet. So in order to get the number of valid tweets that don't have a space in the first box, you take the 95 to 140 functions and subtract the number of functions that have a space in the first box. And so if you that leaves, if you have a space in the first box, that leaves 139 boxes any of which, all of which, or any of which can have a character from the set of characters. So subtracting off the functions that have a space in the first box amounts to subtracting 95 to the 139th power. And you can factor out the 95 to the 139th in this difference, and you get 94 times 95 to the 139th power as the number of tweets. So if you happen to know the map counting theorem, this is a rigorous way of calculating the number of tweets. I think that's a very interesting little application of the map counting theorem. First of all, let's rewrite this in scientific notation and take a look at some large numbers and see how the tweet number stacks up against other commonly encountered very large numbers. We already said the tweet number is way bigger than the Google, which is a well-known large number. So in order to change to scientific notation, we're going to have to rewrite the tweet number as a logarithm base 10. So if you have a number A that equals 10 to the Y, then Y is called the log base 10 of A. Okay? If instead of 10, if we use googol as the base of the logarithm, if you have a number A that's equal to googol to the Y, then this is, Y is called the log to the base G of A, which I like to call the glog function, glog of A equals Y. And you can convert back and forth if A is equal to 10 to the Y, then glog A is equal to Y over 100. This googol logarithm is handy for dealing with really large numbers. We'll see how that works in a little bit. Okay, so let's go ahead and rewrite this expression for the tweet number in as a logarithm base 10. So we need to take the logarithm base 10 of the tweet number. So that's equal to, let's write this out. By the way, we factored 94 into 2 times into prime factors. So 94 is 2 times 47. 95 is 5 times 19. So the tweet number can be factored out in terms of these 4 prime factors. It's a simple composite number with just 4 distinct prime factors. So we have to evaluate this logarithm. And log 2, you can do this on your calculator. So here is the log base 10 of the tweet number. And in scientific notation, the tweet number is equal to 10 to the 276.8767. Now, we have this mini-digit decimal expansion of the log of the tweet number. So our formula up here, this is exact, it's precise, and it's a natural number, and this logarithmic scientific notation formula for the tweet number is an approximation, but you can make this as accurate as you want by just taking more terms in the logarithm. Okay, what about the log of the tweet number. So if we use our formula, the tweet number is also equal to Google to the 2.7687 so forth power. So the tweet number, if you're a fan of numerology, here you go. Notice that the tweet number here is less than Google to the pi and greater than Google to the e, which is sort of a curious result. So let's take a look. This is a large number, but to get some intuition and some context for big numbers like that, let's take a look at some really big numbers. So I've got a chart down here. Log of the tweet number. So let's go down here a little further. I think I have a chart. Yeah, here we go. Here's a chart of some very large numbers. This axis down here on the bottom is the log scale, log base 10 to the 100 power, ranging from 0 to 5. And here are some big numbers that we are kind of run into. Like over here is Avogadro's number. So that's right here. Here's the total number of chess positions possible on the chessboard. It's estimated to be around 10 to the 46.7 power. So that's over here. This would be log of 0.46, log of 0.23 or so. And let me see here. Okay, here's a good one. The number of atoms in the universe. And so that's estimated to be around 10 to the 80th power, with some uncertainty in this exponent. So that has a, that shows up here as 0.8 on this scale. And then here's Google, 10 to the 100. That's 1. And then the Shannon number is an estimate of the number of possible chess games. And that's a pretty big number, 10 to the 120th power. And then there's kind of a gap here, a no man's land. And you get up here to the tweet number, 10 to the 270, let's call it 10 to the 277th power, roughly. So it's much larger than the number of atoms in the universe or the number of possible chess games. There's a name for some very large numbers. The number 1 centillion, which is equal to 10 to the 303rd power, 1 centillion has a log of 3.03. So a centillion is somewhat larger than the tweet number. And then if you really want big numbers, you talk to the number theorists. And so there are these Mersenne numbers. 2 to the n minus 1 is the nth Mersenne number. And so, for instance, the Mersenne number that's a prime, not all of them are prime, but a lot of them are. So the Mersenne number 1279, 2 to the 1,279th power minus 1, is known to be a prime number. And that's sitting up here at log of 3.85 or so. And they're much bigger Mersenne primes. So I think this is a kind of an interesting chart. One of the interesting things about it is that you'll notice that there are no quantities that occur as physics scientific measured quantities in this range here or above. And so Avogadro's number and the number of atoms in the universe and so forth, the size of the universe, even if you calculated, say, the radius of the visible universe in units of the Planck length. The Planck length is 10 to the minus 35 meters or so. The visible universe is estimated to have something like, I think, 49 billion light years in diameter or something. Anyway, so you have these numbers that are pretty big, but the largest number you can construct out of known physical quantities is way less than this tweet number. And I was looking around to see if I could construct a physical quantity that approached magnitude of the tweet number. And it's kind of tricky. It doesn't really occur in physics theories. And the reason is that in physics, there is a smallest length scale, namely the Planck scale, and there's a smallest time scale, namely how long it takes something going at the speed of light to travel one Planck length. So there are these lower bounds on all physical quantities. So if you start dividing them into large physical quantities, you still are limited by how large that division will get you. Let's take a look. Here's just a little curious example down here. Here's one way to get a large number out of physical stuff. So you take the visible universe over here. Follow me on this. So it has a bunch of galaxies and black holes and stuff, and it's estimated there are 10 to the 80th atoms in the universe. Now that's way less than the tweet number over here. So suppose you took every atom in this universe, this 10 to the 80 atoms, and created a brand new universe of the same size for each atom. Okay, so here you've got all these atoms, and for every one of them, you're going to make a brand new universe over here. Okay, and then you count up the total number of atoms in those 10 to the 80th new universes, and you get 10 to the 160th power atoms. So look, you're still way short of this. If you repeat this, now you take that all the atoms in the 10 to the 80th universes and convert them into new universes of the same size. That generation of universes, you have 10 to the 160th universes now. How many atoms is that? That would be 10 to the 240th atoms. So you're getting up there, but you're still less than 10 to the 277th. So if you did this whole thing one more generation, you would exceed the tweet number of atoms in this hypothetical situation where every atom gets converted into a universe, every atom of those new ones gets to be a new universe, and so on, three times. To the chart. So generally, I think we can make an observation that there's this regime of mathematical numbers that is kind of disconnected from anything physical theories can come up with. Physical theories are sort of limited down here in this Googol and sub-Googol range of measurable quantities. You know, actually, this reminds me, there's a famous lecture that Richard Feynman, the famous theoretical physicist, gave. The lecture was called "There's Room at the Bottom." So his point is, his idea was that, well, why don't we build smaller and smaller stuff down to the molecular scale, and we could have a whole technology existing on the molecular scale. This lecture was given a long time ago, and I believe it sort of inspired, got people thinking about how you would do that, and you might say he was sort of the grandfather of the field of nanotechnology based on "There's Room at the Bottom." But there's not an infinite amount of room at the bottom. The smallest, if you keep going down, you're going to run into the Planck length, and there's no more room below the Planck length. So that leads to this no man's land over here, no physics land. And this is just speculation on my part. Maybe some expert theoretical physicist can come up with a big number that comes out of some known valid physical theory. Okay, so here's that. This problem of the tweet number, as you can see, it really kind of opens up the discussion to a lot of stuff, and we were able to touch on the use function theory, result of the map counting theorem to find a value, an exact value for the total number of tweets that are possible. Get this number in context of other large numbers. Well, I hope you enjoyed this discussion. How many tweets are possible? 94 times 95 to the 139th power, and we proved that that's the case. I suppose I should have started this video saying, here's the answer. Pause the video and try to solve it yourself. Anyway, there are other ways of solving this. Maybe what we can say is we'll stop the video here, but there are at least three other intuitive ways to solve this problem and get this same number. And I promise to come back with another video and discuss those. If you come up with something on your own, please leave a message. Send any questions or comments, post them on YouTube. Thanks for watching.